Doesn't like to be for the fall.
No, it's a new for sure.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to DM Contemporary and to Linda Cummings' artist talk. I'm going to make it a very short introduction because I'm sure you have a lot of questions and Linda is here to answer them. She's going to talk a little bit, introduce you to her work and how she got to this stage of her work. Linda has been practicing photography for a very long time. Mm-hmm. Started as a painter and came to photography, but it's been at least 10, 12 years.
Many years.
With DM Contemporary for 10 years. Yeah. We've had a long relationship that way, and it's wonderful. And Linda Cummings.
Changes of the wheat or the corn or whatever was growing. and I found myself later in life going to art school and Nova Scotia College of Art and Design, which is on this beautiful sort of harbor in Halifax. And all of a sudden, I was so captured by water, because I had grown up in this very landlocked, really dry sort of world, and all of a sudden, here was water, and it was just sort of coming and going, sort of like the cycle of nature that, when I was a young girl, really appreciated. So I found myself really kind of captivated by water, and in the same way that I was sort of captivated by, these sort of fields of grain and how they would grow and change and then disappear and grow and change and disappear. And water does the same thing. In a sense, this is why water. I've always been sort of interested in this sort of allegoric world, the world of change and the world of chance. And some of my earlier work had to do with more representational imagery, with slips that were tossed into the air. And then I did a whole series of that you might see in the scroll in the front when you're walking into the gallery, of this sort of sense of change and movement within very small frame of space in New York City, revolving doors at the Guggenheim, the Times Square. But it's always been a kind of structured abandon, where I set a stage and then I kind of watch and sort of picture the experience of what happens in the process of that sort of space unfolding. So this is kind of the history of, the kind of thoughts that I've been always interested in, is how to slow down time and how to look carefully, how to sort of stop and really take in what's around me. And I think that the water, to that, which is kind of the material that I've been working with in the last couple of years, the water is a way that it's a substance that is both appearing and disappearing all the time. It's also a substance that is invisible, relatively speaking. It's a kind of, it takes its color or its substance from other things, like its color from the sky or from what's underneath, or the particles in the water. So it in and of itself, it's invisible. And there's something that's really interesting to me about trying to make visible what's invisible, whether it's a psychological sort of state or whether it's a physical state or an emotional state. So water becomes this really interesting medium for me to be able to sort of explore that process of making what's invisible visible. But it also is something about being able to work with the struggle and change. The way I've been working with this work is that I'm actually drawing right at the very near the water edge, and often I'm in my kayak or on a dock, and I'm making drawings of the surface of the water, and then these drawings are sort of submerged and interact with the water, and I'm stirring the water on the top. My fingers are kind of creating another layer of drawing, and the light kind of refracts and reflects through this process, and what's revealed is the image, but it's a constant struggle because this is a tidal river, and the river, the water is carrying everything away. Just the moment I'm about to snap the shutter, everything changes. So it's something about that embedded struggle that is also really important to me. When I worked with slips, it was the struggle of the wind, always wanting to have some kind of force that I can't control. Photography is, some people approach photography as this sort of ultimate controlling mechanism, but I actually think of the camera as a kind of dream machine or an instrument to draw with. And so that's how I sort of work with the camera, as a a tool to sort of mirror my inner world and the outer world, or find images in the outer world that mirror my inner world. Speaking of water, that's another property of water that I really like, is this fact that it mirrors. And the mythological sort of connotations of water and Narcissus and, you know, so many different stories of the importance of water in our, you know, physical, emotional, psychic life. I think of the river as a kind of muse. It's my muse. It's also, in a strange way, my camera, because it becomes like this mirroring surface that reflects all these images in this constant stream in which there's no end to the images and how they change. And I sort of think about photography in the same way, that it's kind of like this endless stream of images that just keeps going, in the sense that, you know, Susan Sontag talks about there's no final photograph. There really isn't, you know, photographs can be duplicated, reproduced, you know, over and over and over, and you see that all the time. But, you know, how do you locate the moment when you're actually going to take the photograph, when you're actually going to make that picture, when you're actually going to, you know, choose this time from this endless stream of images and frame it in this particular way to sort of picture some part of my own experience. And I call that the kind of moment of urgency. It's like, you know, all these images are going by all the time, and whether I'm on the street in New York, or I'm in the river in Connecticut, or I'm, you know, at a steel mill in Pennsylvania, you know, the plethora of images, and now the plethora of ways of being able to capture images, you know, with videos and iPhones, and, you know, I mean, it's constantly multiplying. So for me, it's not a matter of, you know, getting the right camera, or getting the right angle, or getting the right place, or, you know, it's more about an inner moment of urgency, where something in the outer world kind of like connects to something in my own experience, and that's the moment that the shutter clicks. It's very idiosyncratic, it's very subjective, but it becomes a point of departure. It's a frame of reference for me. It's the moment when I try to make things still from all that's moving, and meditate on that place and stay with that place and try to stop time and stop the motion and sort of connect with the experience. Then what I do after that is work with those images and try to invite sort of the form to come out of the image. So the form will suggest, you know, something in my sort of discussion, talk to my work in the studio. And sometimes it tells me certain things, and other times it tells me other things. And, you know, this time it was saying, I just can't be contained, I won't be. And so I had, I wanted to make it physical. I wanted to start to make the image much more a sense of a flow that really relates to the surface of the water, the surface of my skin when I'm touching the water, that relates to this whole experience of physicality. And so I began to make the images sort of tumble out of the frame. And again, suggesting this idea that, you know, the frame of reference, whatever our frame of reference is so crucial in how we look at and how we frame the world. The technology that we use is, you know, we make the technology and then the technology kind of makes us. And I wanted to suggest that we can create new kinds of frames, and that the work doesn't have to be framed in the same way. These particular images, this is Dark Moon series, and this, again, you know, I'm really fascinated with this sort of evolution of technology and how, in terms of picture making, and how the migration from analog to digital photography in my life has been really powerful. How the image looks and how I relate to the camera and the whole darkroom process, you know, it's really big if you're, you know, as many of us are image makers, this transformation. So I was using, just in a kind of playful way, is that I was putting, you know, my older lenses on my digital camera. So these were like my, so to speak, analog lenses, my film lenses from my old Nikons from the 70s and 80s, and putting them on my digital camera from the, you know, from recently, and looking at the world with these two sort of frames. And it suggested to me a really sort of interesting and stark experience of how much, you know, the frame dictates what we see and what we don't see. So there's this also associations to microscopes and telescopes and, you know, all kinds of other, the moon, you know, we don't know if we're looking at something really far away or we're looking at something really close. And I really like that ambiguity because it's a kind of, you know, I'm trying to create a sense of expanse and, you know, immediacy and connection in the image so that they actually, so the images actually can move as well. Any questions or thoughts?
You know, I'm looking at the scrolls. So I looked at them and I said, that's graphite. How does graphite get under the water?
Yes.
Is it a reflection of reeds? And now we're talking about going and dropping and drawing in. Sort of a two-part question. I guess one is, do you have an urge to draw on the image after it's been printed, or does taking the photograph sort of set that in time for you? Time, I get a feeling that once the photograph is made, then the drawing part ends, and you don't have an urge to do that, but you do have an urge to do that, and would it be something to sort of consider, to sort of like add to or somehow embellish what happened?
I think that that's a beautiful question, and I certainly have the urge, you know, but whether I'll act on that urge or not, I'm not sure, because for me, this process is really about the moment that happens, you know, in that time. And so if I were to draw on it later, I'm not sure that, you know, that it would actually connect in the same way. But I'm also, there is something that, that your question brings up about this longing for the darkroom process. I specifically use silver, I use graphite, I use lead, because I know that the properties of lead will reflect in a certain way underwater, because of my whole, you know, long experience in the darkroom and seeing an image emerge in the silver daylight process. So, and that incredible feeling when you watch the image just like kind of like wake up, and, you know, it's been sleeping for, you know, whatever, a million years, and it comes up and there it is. And so I wanted to evoke that same sort of sense for myself of the image emerging and changing.
So you wanted sort of a sense of a magical moment, and sort of drawing on it, then turn it back into a sort of craft moment, or a making moment, and sort of use that. But it's okay to draw before. I guess you also like the effect of the water on the paper.
The water, it's part of it is that the way I move my hands on the surface of the water is to try to gather the light in a certain way so that it interacts, so that it's both the drawing with the light and with the graphite. And with the water, you know, the image is on the cover.
Right.
So I think to go in later would be to sort of cover up that whole part.
Right.
And I'm not sure that, you know, that there isn't a space for something to come after, but I'm not sure if that's where I, you know, how I would do it. I'm not sure.
Right.
You know, but I think that there's certainly, so does it feel like for you there's an urge to see something drawn on the surface?
Yes and no. You know, the fact that I see what I think is graphite,
it is,
and then it's also mediated by the lens of the water. In fact, the water is a lens, and I guess I understand now from you that the water lens and the camera lens are the two lenses that then make up your image,
right.
And that's sort of.
Yeah.
May I add something to that?
Sure.
Yeah. I don't mean to interrupt you. But 3 years ago, Linda had a show also here in this space called Stirring Water. And there was a whole, all the work basically was where Linda was drawing with the water as the element, as her medium. She was taking her paddle out on her canoe and actually making the motions, marking the water, and then photographing it. And apparently that urge went a little further into the mark making on paper that goes into the water, and then the water is also stirred and moved and used. So there was a process, there was a period just before this where the drawing was happening as a motion.
I can almost see like an Andy Goldsworthy type project where you find a nice shallow stream and you put in your rocks so that it creates the ripples that you want.
Exactly. So she was using whatever colors and grasses. And it was a year-long project that started in the fall and ended in the fall.
Right.
And the colors changed and all of these elements were used and really to make her work at that time.
But I do think the point about this, the graphite, is really important because that is the new introductions into this. And again, thinking about, you know, photography, drawing the light, and also the river as a camera body, as a body itself, a visual body where the water becomes a lens.
Fixing shadows.
And you're fixing shadows. Yeah, and the reeds are very much part of the inspiration, because this is all, you know, very, in the other earlier work that Doris was talking about, it was mostly the linear aspects were made through the reeds that were under the water or shadows of the reeds on the top of the water. So there was an inherent drawing element from the reeds. Now the reeds have become, you know, sort of submerged and the drawings have kind of emerged.
Tell me if I'm wrong, I just noticed that I think there is a new element, one more layer, that you're bringing in more tension because there is your signature, there is your line making underneath.
Yeah.
And then there's the other less controllable element of the water on top, and they are corresponding now.
Yes.
But they're also not always corresponding in the same harmonious way that water alone does.
Exactly.
There is a little something going on there, which makes it probably interesting to you, I can imagine.
Yes.
Tell me if I'm
no, right. That's absolutely right, Carol. I really want there to be struggle and tension, and so I'm always working with in a world where there are competing forces. You know, I'm trying to do one thing and I'm getting subverted from doing that thing. So that's very much part of the work and how I set it up, how I set the stage.
I just want to say this is a beautiful, beautiful showing, and I've watched your work evolve over many years from the slips, and I think I was even with you on a few slips throughout this. And this show just totally resonates with me on so many levels because I'm extremely drawn to water.
living in the static photograph.
Thank you. That's a wonderful observation. I am trying to, because you can see the piece actually moves as you respond. I mean, as somebody just walks by it. So I want the image to have a way to almost kind of reach out and try to touch the viewer.
Manipulate
the patterns of your body moving through the space. So there is this tension again between the static and the moving, the fixed and the fluid. And again, that also resonates on a conceptual level with me in terms of the fluidity of things changing in our world that we can't grasp anymore. Where is the edge? Where is the edge of the image? Where is the edge of a country? Where is the edge of someone's identity? These are all really interesting and problematic questions. Wait.
I was wondering, because you're talking about how the world sort of reflects psychological and rich perhaps. And we're looking at it trying to sell. And I was wondering if you have interest in bodies of water that are not so clean. Because we live in a world where we have our waters and we live in it. So there's a sociological and political layer to water in our world today. I was wondering if you try to focus on those bodies of water as a medium as well.
That's a really good question. Sludge, right? Sludge. Yeah.
Algae and all sorts of.
She wouldn't want to touch the
where it's occluding, it's not.
Where it's not revealing. Well, I actually do have a whole series of works on this same river, which, my good dear friends Chris and Chris, who are sitting in the back row, found a kind of a group called the Friends of Farm River, which is where this river is. And every year we go out and we clean the river, after, at a certain time in the year, but also after, the winter and the hurricanes or things like that. So there is this reclamation process that I'm also photographing. It's, how the river gets, cleaned, if it can get cleaned, and how we then pollute the river. And I also have a lot of images of, the ways in which the human touch is very different than mine, of lots of sediment and garbage and, broken things and plastic pails and, all kinds of stuff that gets thrown up onto the shores. So I'm working on that. I don't quite yet know where and how it's going to come up, to be revealed. But it's definitely in my sort of consciousness. And a lot of my earlier work had a lot more of a political sort of focus to it. And this work is more on a subtle level than, but it's certainly percolating.
Awesome.
Thank you. Thanks.
I just wanted to say the work is always incredible, but it's even more amazing to live with because I have a couple of your pieces and it's really fabulous to have them in your life. So.
Thank you.
But I always wonder, because I know you and I are both recovering Catholics, I always feel this like Catholic stuff in all of your work. This looks really angels. I feel the sense of a Catholic experience has a lot of light to it because there's usually stained glass and other things going on. And I can always feel it from all of the different kinds of work I've seen you do. So I wonder if you ever notice any of that. That experience came to.
Well, that's really interesting.
Thank you.
I never thought of these as a baptismal thing, but
it's a fun.
But it is a fun. So I don't know how it's connecting now, but you can't take that out of you, unfortunately.
You keep trying.
Right? You keep struggling. I did a whole series. In the church
trying to work that out of my system. But it's interesting that no matter how well, you keep taking yourself with you, right? So, I don't know. Yes, the light, the idea of light and inspiration, you know, certainly are very connected.
And infinity.
And infinity, yeah. And sacrifice. I mean, well, you wouldn't know the kinds of sacrifice. But all of you who are artists know the kinds of sacrifice that goes into, you know, our work. And so I don't know where that connects to the Catholic theme, but do they look like crosses to you?
No. I just get a feeling. No, it's the good part. There was some good, you know, the good part that reminds me of. I can't put my finger on it. I just wondered if you ever noticed.
I have, but not in this particular work, but now I will be looking for it. I do want to say that in terms of this size, you know, somebody asked, you know, I think you asked earlier, Sarah, where do you end the image? You know, how do you decide where to cut it, you know, the frame? How are you, you know, how do you decide that? And most of the time with the hanging pieces, I made a decision. You know, to frame it within the architecture of my own body, so that it, you know, that pretty much shoulder length and head to toe, so that you would, the viewer would be feeling like they were encountering an adult body, you know, a body of water.
That's cool.
A body of this, you know, so that it's a
subliminal. The same kind of, you were talking about that moment of urgency, and I was hearing that as a commitment. There's a time that you're looking at all these things changing and how you're affecting them, and then at one point in time there's a commitment that I'm going to capture this.
Yeah.
And it, to me, that's, you're talking about the same kind of thing, your commitment of where does it end, or with the visual field.
Yeah. Where does it end? And how can I create a sense of the ending that isn't really final, but, you know, provisional.
How big are the drawings that go in the water? Are they the same size, or scroll drawings?
No, they're different sizes, but mostly, you know, about 20 by 24.
And are some of these the lines, are they actually making fingers, like drag of fingers?
It could be fingers, it could be beads underneath, it could be, in this case over here, where I think you're looking at those, is, I think those are graphite mostly. You know, I use different sort of techniques of the graphite so that, you know, I'm evoking a certain pattern, light and dark, as well with the drawing. It's not just a representational edge, but a certain kind of like vibrational edge.
And so what's the vision of you? Are you, are feet in the water? Are you in a boat? Do you have a tribe? I'm just curious.
Yes.
What's the picture of you?
The picture of me? Well, it changes a lot.
It's right there.
Right.
Yeah, right. The picture of me. But I don't know if you guys have seen me in the water doing my thing, but we were talking about doing a video where we would, you know, sort of walk across the water. I'm not the top. There we go. We didn't get to that yet. It's in all things, you know, this sort of, you know, being able to defy nature, human nature. And it is in the photography, too. I mean, there is a way that the camera holds this promise of being able to, you know, stop time and stop life and stop, you know, preserve a loved one for, you know, ever. But anyway, yes, where I am in the water, I'm either in, actually physically in the water and drawing on a dock. There's a little dock by the water, so I'm actually physically in the water. I like to be in the water or close to the water. So I'm either on this sort of rocking dock that moves with the water, or I'm in my kayak and it's moving. So I want my body to be moving, rocking at the same time that I'm drawing. Or I'm actually standing in the water. Letting the water. I want to be informed by the movement, you know, the substance of the water.
So they're happening at the same time. You're actually drawing under the water.
Some of them are drawn under the water, some are drawn on top of the water, and then I'm drawn under the water. water, and then the camera right there. You know, it's all just sort of happening in the same frame of time, which is pretty small.
I was wondering about the thought process while you're drawing.
Yeah.
Do you keep a record kind of what you're thinking about? Like, or what has been leading you to this moment, where this moment of drawing is, in fact?
I don't keep an actual record, you know, in words, but, you know, I do have a certain kind of body memory or rhythm, you know, that I'm connecting to. And so that's really the inspiration for the drawing, is much more about a sense of, you know, basically connection. If it's a really rainy or cold day, you know, the drawing will look a certain way, and if it's a really warm day, it'll look a different way. So it's basically that I'm trying to draw in relation actually to the surface of the water, as if I was making a portrait of a person, you know, and you're drawing their face and their features, and I'm drawing this portrait of a field, which I, again, you know, maybe there's a field of dreams, you know, this field, which is the surface of the water.
And the photograph becomes the record.
Yeah.
Right? So you're really responding to the water first.
Yes.
So that's the first step.
That's the first step.
And then drawing responds back.
Yes,
through the water.
Okay. So it's a reciprocal relationship.
I don't know too much about graphite.
Like, you know,
I know what graphite is, but how does it have to do with the
piece of the drawing? I usually work with either a kind of artist paper, like a Strathmore paper, or a Mylar kind of paper or vellum. So I've been experimenting with lots of different kinds of papers, and then I actually draw. No, this goes into the water, and then the photograph is this experience of the tide sort of taking the drawing and doing what it does, and then stirring the water. So, I mean, there's a couple of different layers.
Left, you drew a grid.
I drew a grid, yes.
And then submerged it,
yes.
And then the water did its thing.
Yeah. And these were more specifically trying to sort of locate this idea of the uncontrollable. Try very hard to grid and measure and contain, and how, you know, hard that is to do.
Oh, what were the letters that you put on your water? What were they about?
That's what I was
going to ask. Is that what you're going to ask?
That's the moment.
Well, they were sort of love letters to my students. I teach at ICP, and at the end of every semester, make books, and so I say love letters because they are love letters. That would be, you know, sort of unprofessional, I guess. Get fired for that, right? But, you know, they're just letters expressing my gratitude for them, you know, during the class. And then I sort of, so I like to obscure it as much as possible so that they don't really know what I'm saying.
So, there are letters to your students that you write, that you use here, and they never
see them.
Yeah. So
no, they do. I did actually make, you know, some of the small piece that was inserted into the book, and everybody got one of those books. So it's kind of a class project. But again, you know, my students, I really have this feeling about, you know, the viewer, the audience, as being really much a lot a part of the shaping of process that I do, and so I feel that way about my students too. That, you know, they really give me a lot in terms of their questions, their thoughts, their yearnings, their longings. They connect me to, you know, who I was when I was struggling and starting, and I still am struggling and thinking about starting. But, you know, so that's why.
I keep looking at these two,
yeah,
because to me they're somewhat erotic.
Yes.
In the way that they look. And they're very different.
Yeah. Working in water is a very erotic experience. You know, I mean, it's just, it is. I mean, we are water, and it's all about, you know, the insides of the body and the outsides of our body, and how much, you know, can we keep the inside. inside in and the outside out, and, you know, all that. So I was, Katie and I were talking about this. Katie, actually, I just want to introduce Katie in the middle of our group, because she actually printed all of these pieces for me. She's a wonderful printmaker and artist herself. But we were just having this conversation last night, and she was saying, you know, they're just so sexual, you know. And
so
so I, you know, I don't go in with the intention of, you know, that, but, you know, if you think about, I mean, I have to sort of respond to my own excitement, you know, and that it comes out. So.
It's interesting to me. I'm a singer. The way that you're describing your experience of the creative process and also your interaction with the viewer is very much the way I feel like as a singer, because I'm producing the sound that's very organic in terms of my reaction to and kind of mutual reaction to people who are hearing me, and there's a shared energy. So
it's a kind of performance, you know, for you know, with and others, you know, a shared experience. And I do, even though so much of what I do is very solo and in the studio,
yeah,
as you know, practice it, but then there has to be this moment when, you know, it can be
a shared experience.
It can be shared.
And even though, you know, you might record a performance and you might capture a photograph at the time, there's still an interactivity.
Yeah, that's true. And I also think about the people who came before me. You know, I always am drawing on the, you know, artists and photographers and, you know, philosophers and writers who have come before me, and I am still drawing on their work. So, you know, just you know, culture is an incredible carrier of, you know, shared experience.
And one
of blurring the other.
Yeah. I think it's easier to forget, you know, who's in charge. Like, is the machines in charge? Are we in charge, you know?
But what you just said, Sarah, overlaps in many ways. I remember when Joseph first looked at these works, and we were talking about the flow of the water, and Joseph also added also the flow out of the printer, the frame, and the digital printer. That is actually the way they fall out, and it seems like there are so many overlaps between the machine-made and natural existing, and then her
submerging something you make by hand in the water, you know, that's her Catholic thing or whatever. Mm-hmm. Just, I mean, is that more personal? Mm-hmm. Personal. As we sit here and you talk more, we're able to see more of the personal things that you're not describing, because there's all this technical, interesting performance part of what you do.
Yeah.
And it takes a long time to go and see what you're really doing and to take that veil off. Mm-hmm. Hiding myself, but here I am to see, you know,
in your earlier works, where you actually putting the slip in there, it was actually putting the female or the artist into, and we do have two of them here. For those of you who are not familiar, we keep referring to them, and they're so abstract.
She said the female. I just think as a woman in our culture, how we're veiled. I mean, we're not veiled like Middle Eastern women, but we are
submerged.
Oh, that's it. I'm just learning. Yeah. That's what you're.
Thank you.
So this, for example, is one of the images of the slip in this Cairo Stadium, which is over underneath the Cambridge. Anyway. This is what Jessica was referring to. You know, I would be a friend of mine or my assistant or whatever would be on the sidelines tossing the slip, and then in these very gendered sort of environments. Here's another one that's also from that same series, and these are pre Photoshop, so this is not any kind of digital. In overlay or whatever. It's a straight photograph. And they're very hard to get because, you know, the slip doesn't always open.
It slips away.
It slips away. But again, I wanted to work with the slip basically for that reason, because it also evokes on a verbal level, you know, this whole idea of slippage, you know, and slip of the tongue again, you know. And then this is the Guggenheim before it was changed, before the front facade was changed, those old doors, spinning doors, and the people going in and out of the doors. So this actually is a scroll form too, but in a horizontal and very different kind of format. And I did this work for several years, and slip work for about 10 years, and I usually spend 5 to 10 years working on a body of work. So,
you know what I appreciate so much about the ones with the slip too. I happen to have one of those, which I cherish every day. But I love that it has a humorous aspect to it. You're not taking yourself all that seriously. You know, you're not the question. You're playing with all these images of femininity in our world and where it stands. And the masculine world, but it's also funny. It's so light. And
yes, there has to be a sense of play in the moment for me. Yeah, because I think that's where creativity really like bursts out. You know, when we're not looking, when we're not trying.
Mm-hmm.
You can try, and then all of a sudden you stop drawing. Anyway, thank you all very, very much for coming.
Thank you.